10 little soldier boys went out to dine. One choked his little self, and then there were nine. 9 little soldier boys sat up very late. One overslept himself, and then there were 8. 8 little soldier boys traveling in Devon. One said he'd stay there, and then there were 7. 7 little soldier boys chopping up sticks. One chopped himself in halves, and then there were 6. 6 little soldier boys playing with a hive. A bumblebee stung one, and then there were 5. 5 little soldier boys going in for law. One got into chancery, and then there were 4. 4 little soldier boys going out to sea. A red herring swallowed one, and then there were 3. 3 little soldier boys walking in the zoo. A big bear hugged one, and then there were 2. 2 little soldier boys sitting in the sun. One got frizzled up, and then there was 1. 1 little soldier boy left all alone. He went and hanged himself, and then there were none.
I want to thank everyone for coming down quickly, orderly, getting seated nicely. You are all in for a wonderful treat. Book Day 2017 is really going to be something outstanding, a special day for the yeshiva. I know you've all been prepped in terms of reading the book and what's going to be, so you're probably excited about all the different things that are going to take place as part of the day. It's a really exciting day. This is, if I'm not mistaken, our 4th book day that we've run, and each one has been better than the next, and I'm sure today is going to be the best of all. So please sit back, enjoy the presentations, the classes, the sessions, and all the other parts that make this a really exciting day. It's really fantastic. I want to thank all the people that helped make this day a reality. Way too many for me to list expressly. At the top of the list are the library staff and English department, and those are headed by our English department chair, Ms. Micah Bloom, and our library department chair, Ms. Rachel Kurtz, and Mr. Brian Katz, who puts in his tremendous efforts as well. So let's get started. Let's have a great day. To begin the program, our department, the department chair of the library, Ms. Rachel Kurtz. Thank you.
Well, here we are. Welcome to Book Day 2017. Before we begin the program, let's start by giving credit where it's due. Firstly, thank you to Mrs. Lorraine Bitesh for graciously sponsoring and arranging the guest and faculty luncheon in honor of her children, Teddy and Lily. And also to Ms. Shifra Hannon, Ms. Amy Bitesh, and Ms. Rochelle Dweck for helping with that as well. Many thanks to our guest and faculty presenters who prepared fascinating and insightful sessions for our sessions, and much gratitude to Ms. Shelley Kaplowitz and Mr. Jeffrey Lazar and the travel troupe for the dramatic productions. Warm thank yous to the wonderful Ms. Therese Berkowitz, who could not be here today, and Mr. Jason Novetsky for their artistic creations all around the building. And kudos to Mr. Adam Hofstadter and the intrepid Phoenix staff, and to Morris Mamie for the fabulous Book Day Committee t-shirts. Okay. Thank you to the incredibly organized and reliable Joey Berkowitz and the AV squad. And we extend our appreciation to our student committee members whose enthusiasm and efforts make the day run so smoothly. Okay. All right. I'm going to quickly run through the schedule of the day to make sure we're all aware of how this day works. When this assembly concludes, you will all quickly make your way to your session rooms. Okay, that's how we start. You were all notified of your sessions, and you will have, and if you have somehow forgotten what they are, all around the building, including right outside this auditorium, right straight out, there are booklets posted on the walls in the hallways under the big red arrow listing each student's sessions by class, so you can't get lost. There is also one, outside this auditorium, and attendance will be taken in each session, so make sure you attend the session to which you were registered. At the bell, you will, and then after your first session, we all run by the bells after the assembly, and you will smoothly move to your second session, and then at the next bell is 12 o'clock to 12:45 is your lunch. It's one lunch. And then after that, you come back for your third session, your fourth session, and then come down back to the auditorium for the closing assembly. And then you will have mincha here in the auditorium from 3 to 3:15, and then you go back to regular sessions for the day, your normal classes. Now, let's begin our production by introducing our keynote speaker. Mr. David Kletchik attended the Yeshiva Flatbush for both elementary and high school and graduated with the class of 1987. In fact, he was a Flatbush Falcon on the basketball team, both JV and varsity. His good buddy since fifth grade is none other than our own Mr. Howie Rothbart. After graduating from Yeshiva Flatbush, he went on to study at New York University and Brooklyn Law School, and then on to working at the Brooklyn District Attorney's Office for the next 20 years. He rose steadily through the ranks, and now is the Bureau Chief of Trials, Division 4, in what's known as the Green Zone part of Brooklyn, where he is responsible for both trial productivity and conviction rate of the assistant district attorneys under his supervision. David works closely with the current district attorney, Eric Gonzalez, and is in frequent communication with ranking members of the New York Police Department, while also working closely with the judiciary and defense bar, while maintaining open ties with the members of the Brooklyn community. Married for 16 years and the proud father of four children, everyone, please welcome Mr. David Kletchik.
Every Thursday night, 19-year-old Shoshana Goldberg goes to her friend's house and Brooklyn College classmate for their weekly study group. Sometimes they study art history, sometimes they study sociology. But Thursday, February 9th, they were studying economics. Shoshana was a good student. She graduated a yeshiva high school. Her parents were both professionals, and she planned on going to medical school after she graduated from Brooklyn College. On Thursday, February 9th, like every other Thursday night for the last month, Shoshana left her friend's house at about 11 p.m. to go home. She got into her car and drove west on Avenue J towards Ocean Parkway. But Thursday, February 9th, was not like any other Thursday night. That Thursday night, Shoshana's life was changed forever. At around 11:15 p.m. that same Thursday night of February 9th, Lin Chang finished his last food delivery. He was riding on his motor scooter, and he too was on his way home. And when he got to Avenue J and East 8th Street, he stopped at a red traffic signal. But Lin Chang never made it home that night because an eyewitness observed Shoshana Goldberg failed to stop at that red light, or even to slow down for that matter, and watched as Shoshana's car collided into the back of Mr. Chang's motor scooter. Mr. Chang flew up into the air and fell onto her windshield. The eyewitness called 911. The police arrived, and Mr. Chang was pronounced dead at the scene. Shoshana remained at the scene, and the police recovered Shoshana's cell phone that was right on her lap. The evidence showed that on her cell phone at 11:14 p.m., there was an outgoing text message. The 911 call was made at 11:16. and there was an outgoing text message from Shoshana's cell phone at 11:18 p.m. stating, "I just killed somebody." The police arrested Shoshana for criminally negligent homicide, and the case was sent to the DA's office to prosecute and evaluate. Was this a terrible accident or criminal behavior? If Shoshana's conduct was criminal, should she go to jail, or is a probation sentence sufficient instead of jail? Who makes these decisions, and what is the next step in the criminal justice system? I'm here today to answer those questions. I will talk to you about what happens after somebody gets arrested, and the role of the prosecutor, and the awesome responsibility that an assistant district attorney has on people's lives, and what I do as bureau chief in the Brooklyn District Attorney's Office. I first want to talk to you about how the district attorney's office is organized. The district attorney divided Brooklyn into 5 geographical zones, and each bureau covers 4 or 5 different precincts in Brooklyn, which represent different parts of Brooklyn. So each bureau handles approximately 20% of the cases in Brooklyn. My bureau is called the Green Zone, and we prosecute all crimes in 5 precincts in Brooklyn. It includes the 60th precinct, which is Coney Island, the 61st precinct, which is Sheepshead Bay and Brighton Beach, the 70th precinct, which we're all here right now, covers Flatbush, the 71st precinct, which covers Crown Heights, and the 72nd precinct, which covers Sunset Park. Any crime that happens in these precincts is handled by my bureau. From the low-level misdemeanor crimes, such as fare beats, graffiti, possession of a small amount of drugs, or even a simple assault, to the more serious felonies of attempted murder, shootings, robberies, and burglaries. So what is the role of the prosecutor when it comes to handling these cases? The role of the prosecutor is to seek justice, not merely to put people in jail. But what does that actually mean? It means that when evaluating a particular case, whether it be an attempted murder or a shoplifting, and deciding who and how to prosecute the case, it is always the job of the prosecutor, the ethical duty of the prosecutor, to do the right thing. Let's talk about the other roles in the criminal justice system. There's a defense attorney. The defense attorney has the job of protecting his or her legal rights, even at the expense of public safety. The judge makes sure the court's proceedings are fair to both sides and makes sure both sides are following the rules and the laws. It is only the prosecutor that is obligated to seek the truth, is obligated to make sure that innocent people are not prosecuted and that guilty people are held accountable and that communities are safe. So let's go back to the case of the people of the state of New York versus Shoshana Goldberg. The evidence is clear, and the people would have no problem proving beyond a reasonable doubt that on the night of February 9th, Shoshana Goldberg was driving in a vehicle on Avenue J, and when she approached the intersection of East 8th Street and Avenue J, despite a red light, she didn't stop or even slow down. And that because she was texting on her cell phone while driving, and as a result collided into the rear of Mr. Chang's motor scooter, causing his death. The facts are not in dispute, and the evidence was clear that Shoshana caused Mr. Chang's death when she texted on her phone while driving, instead of using the due care that is required while driving a vehicle. So what is the right and just result here? Is Brooklyn a safer place with Shoshana in jail? The answer might be yes, if we believe this is something she will do again. The answer also might be yes if we think that sentencing her to jail has a deterrent effect, meaning maybe others won't text and drive if they know that they could also go to jail. Or is offering Shoshana a non-jail disposition a more appropriate sentence, especially considering her young age, her lack of criminal history, the fact that she's a college student, and by sending her to jail, we are potentially taking away the opportunity to go to medical school and to getting a job. Maybe making sure Shoshana goes to graduate school and becomes a productive member of society makes Brooklyn a safer place than just sending her off to prison. But wait, Let's not forget that her actions had very serious consequences. The death of an innocent person who was killed simply for being in the wrong place at the wrong time. Let's not forget the impact this crime had on the victim's family. It is also important to balance the interest and feeling of the victim's family when considering punishment. So does Shoshana deserve to go to jail simply as a punishment for her criminally negligent actions that caused the death of Mr. Shank? If you had to choose Shoshana's sentence, what would you choose? I'm going to give you choices. I'm going to ask afterwards for a show of hands. Would you choose 1 year in jail or more, 6 months in jail, 90 days in jail, no jail, but a 5-year probation and community service? Or maybe you think, no, this isn't a crime, and this is just a terrible accident. So please, by show of hands, who thinks that justice demands that Shoshana should be sentenced to 1 year in jail or more? Okay. 6 months in jail? 90 days in jail? Who thinks no jail, 5 years probation, and community service? Is there anybody here who believes that no punishment should be held and that this was just a terrible accident? You could raise your hand. Well, these are the types of decisions that an attorney in the DA's office has to make. But let me tell you what actually happened here. It was only after speaking to the victim's family and after considering Shoshana's age and the fact that she's a student and that she has no criminal record that the DA gave Shoshana 5 years probation, 500 hours of community service, and had to give lectures in schools about the danger of texting and driving. These are difficult, difficult decisions to make. On any given day, I review between 25 and 30 cases with attorneys in my bureau. I evaluate the facts of each case with them, just like we did with Shoshana Goldberg's case. We review the strengths and weaknesses of the case to determine whether we have proof beyond a reasonable doubt. We determine, is there DNA evidence? Is there video surveillance? Were there any witnesses to the crime? If there are witnesses, are they cooperative? Is the victim cooperative? What was the motive of the crime? Are there any possible defenses? Maybe self-defense. Maybe the witness was mistaken. Or worse, maybe the witness is lying. But most importantly, we determine what is the best and most just way to handle the case, whether it be a trial, a plea, or a possible program. A topic that is getting more and more attention is how should the criminal justice system respond to 16 and 17-year-old defendants. New York is only one of a few states that treat 16 and 17-year-olds as adults. The New York criminal system can treat 16 and 17-year-olds as youthful offenders, but the general rule in New York is if you are involved in adult behavior, such as gunpoint robberies, burglaries, or robberies, you're going to be treated as an adult. It's the difference in the sentencing guidelines between defendants treated as an adult and defendants treated as youthful offenders, which is really quite staggering. For example, an adult found guilty of a robbery with a gun could be sentenced, found guilty after trial, must be sentenced to a minimum of 5 years in jail and the maximum of 25 years in jail. But if a defendant is considered a youthful offender and is convicted of the same exact crime, the sentence could be as low as probation, and the maximum amount of jail is 1 1/3 years to 4 years. It's a very big difference. The acting district attorney, Eric Gonzalez, opened a young adult court whose purpose is to give young adults a second chance in life so they won't be saddled with a criminal conviction that will affect them getting into school or getting a job down the road. The district attorney's office also offers a very rigorous program to young adults that are gang members and charged with felony offenses, and this is called Project Redirect. In this program, young adults are required to wear ankle bracelets, they're required to go to therapy, go to school, They are prohibited to hang out with their old friends, and they are not allowed to be on social media, and they're even prohibited from wearing certain colors. If they follow these rules over an 18 to 24 month period, their criminal case will be dismissed. If they don't, there is a high jail alternative. But if these young adults do complete the program, both the defendant and society wins. They are no longer part of a gang. They are going to school. They can get a job and be productive members of society. This is yet another example of the tremendous impact that the district attorney's office can have on society. And that goal of keeping the public safe can be attained in many ways. We see that not every suspect who is arrested must be prosecuted in the same way. Each case must be evaluated separately and on its own merits. The longer I do this job, the more I realize that sometimes we prosecute people that are not bad people, but at any particular moment, they made a very bad decision. One bad decision, and it's a decision they wish they could take back. One particular sad case comes to mind. After a long day at a construction site, two construction workers, Jay and Pete, friends and co-workers, went for dinner and drinks. Unfortunately for both of them, they both had too much to drink. When the bill came, there was an argument about how much money each owed. They each threw down some money on the table, stormed out of the restaurant, and waited outside. Outside the restaurant, Jay, despite being much bigger and much stronger than Pete, took out a machete. Yes, a machete, a 15-inch blade, and threatened to kill Pete. Pete backed away and crossed the street. Jay threw the machete to the ground and also walked away in the opposite direction of Pete. Pete should have just walked away too, but he didn't. He crossed the street and followed Jay. When he got close, Jay took off his jacket, ready to fight. But at that moment, Pete took out a box cutter from his jacket pocket and slashed Jay on his arm. Pete ran away. Jay staggered a little bit, fell to the ground, and bled to death. The next day, Pete was arrested. Pete was brought to the police station and asked whether he wanted to make a statement. Pete said yes. Pete was read his Miranda warnings. The prosecutor at the precinct asked Pete if he knew why he was being arrested. Pete answered, "Yes, I did something very serious." The prosecutor answered, "Yes, when somebody dies, it's very serious." And it was only at that moment that Pete learned that his coworker and friend, Jay, died. Pete couldn't stop crying. He had no idea that Jay died. And it was clear from his reaction that Pete did not intend to kill him. In any event, Pete was charged with manslaughter, which is the intent to cause serious physical injury and cause the death of another. This whole incident was caught on video surveillance. And when you watch the incident from beginning to end, it's very hard to feel sympathy for the victim. The victim is twice the size of the defendant. The victim was the initial aggressor when he threatened the defendant with the machete. And even when the defendant crossed the street, the victim was still ready to fight. But the moment the defendant made the decision to follow the victim across the street, after the first confrontation was over, and take out a box cutter and swing it at the victim who had no weapon in his hand, everything changed. The defendant had no intention to kill the victim, and yet his action led to that very consequence, and he was held accountable under the law for the unintended death of his friend. This case went to trial. The first trial resulted in a hung jury, meaning the jury cannot make a unanimous decision one way or the other. The second trial, the defendant was convicted of manslaughter in the first degree. But the judge sentenced him to the minimum amount of jail that he could, 5 years jail. And I think if the judge was able to sentence him to less by law, he would have done that as well. Both cases that I presented to you today are examples of defendants that seemed to be hardworking, decent folks that made a bad decision that had fatal consequences. And in both cases, the law demanded that they be held accountable. When I was asked to come speak at Yeshiva Flatbush for Book Day, I was not only honored, but I was very, very happy. Because after all these years, I get to come back here and say thank you. Yeshiva Flatbush had a tremendous impact on my life. I got a first-rate education that had prepped me for college and law school. I made friends in elementary school that I have until today, including Mr. Howie Rothbard, who was like a brother to me. I graduated Yeshiva Flatbush proud to be Jewish and ready for any challenge before me, absolutely. I was instilled with a love for the Jewish religion in Israel that I still have to this day. Yeshiva Flatbush gave me a solid Jewish foundation and prepared me for the outside world that didn't have Rukudim on Rosh Chodesh. I credit Yeshiva Flatbush with the success that I've enjoyed rising through the ranks of the Brooklyn District Attorney's Office to my current position as Bureau Chief in the DA's office. I was taught how to think critically and thoroughly, and the education I received helped me develop the skills to proper evaluate cases and hopefully do the right thing. Thank you very much.
Okay, Phoenix staff and Mr. Hofstetter and Mr. Klechik, please come to the stage. We're having a Q&A.
I just wanted to quickly introduce everybody up here. David Azarek is the editor-in-chief of the Phoenix. Estelle Saad is the senior editor. Mimi Lazarowitz is our world news editor. Jane Sakai is the managing editor. And Esther Levy is the senior editor. Estelle, let's start with you.
How did you come to your job today, and did you know what you wanted to do right after high school?
I always knew I wanted to be a lawyer, but I didn't really know what kind. It was really by chance. I was working as a Hebrew school teacher where I met somebody in the Brooklyn District Attorney's Office, and a paralegal position opened up. So after college, I actually worked for 2 years as a paralegal in the Brooklyn DA's office. And it was really only then I said, this is the job I wanted. And the truth is, I went to law school, I worked as a paralegal for 2 years, went to Brooklyn Law School full time. My first summer job was also at the Brooklyn DA's office. I wanted to go back the second year. They told me, no, you have to see if there's something else out there. I did check out something else, you know, in a law firm, but I knew that being a prosecutor was in my blood. It was something I wanted to do. And 20 years later, here I am.
Esther, why don't you go next?
How do you feel your Jewish identity has impacted the way you approach your job and your position?
That's a great question. Everything about my job, you know, is about who I am. And being Jewish and the Jewish education that I received always taught me that the number one part of anything is your character, to be honest and to treat people fairly. So those are the philosophy that I took with me to the Brooklyn DA's office, so that every case that I approach, I realize that you're dealing with people, not just with cases. So there are victims, and you must treat those victims properly with fairness, that they went through a tough experience. But on the other hand, even the defendant who committed the crime is a person as well. And you have to treat that person fairly too, and look at a case properly. And my Jewish education taught me to be fair and honest, and that's how I approach my job.
Jane?
What is the most interesting part of your job?
The most interesting part of my job is going to court every single day. Every single day I go to court and I see how the cases that we are dealing with affect people's lives every day. I see the defendants who are being charged with the crime. I see their family members in court. And I see the effect it has on them as well, which keeps me grounded. But I also meet with the victims of the case too, because it's always important to know that what the victim wants in a case is also very important.
David?
Do you believe in the idea of mandatory minimums in sentencing is inherently unfair? Should a judge be given more leeway in regards to sentencing?
Thanks for the softball question. That's a tough question. It's a tough question because the laws are made to try to treat everybody fairly. And what the minimum sentences do is they treat all cases the same. What I appreciate about my job is even when there are minimum sentences, even if a person is charged with a robbery in the first degree that I spoke about before, where the minimum jail is 5 years, as a district attorney, I have discretion to reduce that charge to something lower if I don't think that jail time is necessary or appropriate. I could offer probation, I could offer community service, I could reduce a case to a misdemeanor if that's what's appropriate. So minimum sentences are tough. I think they're appropriate for cases where, especially after trial, that a judge has to deal with. But I know for myself, I get to be flexible with the sentencing guidelines.
Mimi?
Is there a specific type of case that you feel is the most difficult to work on?
I'm sorry?
Is there a specific type of case that you feel is the most difficult to work on?
I've been doing this for a very long time, and I have really prosecuted every sort of case there is, from sexual abuse to domestic violence to murder cases, attempted murders. They're all difficult because they all deal with people. And there is somebody that either was hurt or lost a family member. They're all very difficult type of cases that you have to take seriously, and you have to put in a lot of time and effort to try to make sure that you do the appropriate thing.
Esther, let's go back to you.
You mentioned earlier some of the dilemmas you face when solving cases. Would you mind elaborating on the different ethical dilemmas you might face in terms of you ethically, yourself personally, feeling one way and the law forcing you to act in another way?
So the beauty of my job is at all times I get to follow my ethical conscience. So for example, if a person is arrested and there is either no real evidence or evidence that really doesn't connect the defendant to a particular crime, I'm allowed to dismiss that case. So I don't really feel that ethical dilemmas of prosecuting cases that I don't believe in. Because if I don't believe a case happened, if I don't believe a crime happened, then I'm not going to prosecute that case. Which is different, say, from a defense attorney. No, right, it's different than a defense attorney who has the ethical obligation to defend their client regardless of what, you know, whether the defendant, their client, is innocent or guilty.
We'd love to stay and do this for longer, but I'm being told that our time is just about up, so thank you very much.
My pleasure.
For those of you lucky enough to be in Mr. Klechik's sessions, you can follow up with your own questions. And now if Rabbi Harari will come up front, please. Is he here? He's not here? Okay. So we'll move on with the drama troupe.
I just came to say, you're quite right, Rogers. Look for yourself. There are only 7.
Rogers, can you fetch me a pad? Thank you. Well, doctor?
No question of heart failure or anything like that. MacArthur was hit with a life preserver or some sort of thing on the back of the head.
Did you find the actual weapon used?
I'm afraid not.
Nevertheless, you are quite sure of your facts.
I'm quite sure.
Well, we all know exactly where we are.
This morning, while I was sitting on the terrace, I was an observer of your activities. There could be little doubt of your purpose. You were searching the island for an unknown murder?
Quite right, ma'am. We wanted to see if this Mr. Owen was in charge of the Marston and Rogers deaths.
He's a madman, a loony. That almost certainly. But our main preoccupation is this, to save our lives.
There's no one else on the island. No one.
In the sense you mean, no. I came to that conclusion early this morning. I could have told you that your search would be fruitless. Nevertheless, I'm strongly of the opinion that Mr. Owen, to use the name that he himself has adopted, is on the island. Very much so. Given the scheme in question, which is simply the execution of justice on those whom the law cannot touch, there's only one way in which that scheme can be accomplished. Mr. Owen came to the island in only one way. It is very clear. Mr. Owen is one of us.
Oh, no, no, no!
Ma'am, I think the judge has a point, and I think we're all in danger.
What do you mean? We checked the island. No one is here. Mr. Lombard and Miss Gloria are both correct. Mr. U.N. Owen is one of us.
But who? It certainly isn't me.
That is an excellent question, but the only certainty, Dr. Armstrong, is that it was not Anthony Martson, Mr. Rogers, and the recently deceased General MacArthur. There are seven of us left. Of those seven, one is, if I may so express myself, a bogus little soldier boy. Are we all in agreement?
It's fantastic, but I suppose you're right.
Not a doubt of it, and if you ask me, I have a very good idea.
We will come to that presently. But first, let us establish that we are all in agreement.
Your argument seems logical. I agree that one of us is possessed by a devil.
I can't believe it! I can't!
Lombard?
I agree, ma'am. Absolutely.
Now, let us examine the evidence. To begin with, is there any reason for suspecting one particular person? Miss Bloor, I believe you wanted to say something.
Mr. Lombard's got a revolver. He didn't tell the truth last night. He admits it.
I suppose I'd better explain again. I wasn't sent a letter or some such nonsense to get me to come to the island. I was hired by some Jew boy named Morris. He knew I could trust to keep my eye out for anything out of the ordinary, and I'm resourceful in a tight spot. As for the gun, I keep it on me in case something becomes too out of the ordinary. It's helped me out of some tough spots before.
And we're supposed to just take your word on it? Who could corroborate your story?
Sadly, we can only rely on each other's words.
None of you have quite grasped what a peculiar situation this is. Is there anyone we can definitely eliminate from suspicion based on the evidence in our possession?
I'm a well-known professional, man. The mere idea that I can be suspected of a murder is absurd.
Dr. Armstrong! So am I, but it wouldn't be the first time a doctor went mad. People of all types do on occasion. Doctors, judges, even policemen.
Well, we could exclude Miss Brent and Miss Claythorne.
And why would that be so? Are they too young or too old for such crimes?
Well, Dr. Armstrong, are either of them capable of bludgeoning the general hard enough to kill him in one shot?
Well, of course. I mean, with the right tool, a child could have done it.
And anyone could have slipped poison into their drinks.
You're all mad! I could never!
Control yourself, young lady. I am not accusing you, nor Miss Brent. You're not offended by my including you in the possible suspects, are you, Miss Brent?
The idea that I should be accused of taking a fellow creature's life, not to speak of the lives of three fellow creatures, is of course quite absurd to anyone who knows anything about my character. But I understand the fact that we're all strangers to one another, and that in those circumstances, nobody could be exonerated without the fullest proof. There is, as I've said before, a devil amongst us.
Good. So we're in agreement then.
What about Rogers?
What about her?
Well, it seems to me we could rule her out.
Why so?
Well, she doesn't quite seem smart enough for it, and her husband is one of the victims.
In my time, I have seen quite a few black widows.
I see what you mean. Perhaps she could to cover up for herself, keep her from squealing, but I don't see her being the mastermind Mr. Owen we're dealing with.
That is the difference between speculation and evidence. We don't know that the couple killed their employer to begin with, and thus have no reason for conjecture on why Mr. Rogers was killed.
Well, have it your own way. You and Owen is one of us, no exceptions.
My point is that there can be no exceptions based on character or position or probability. We must now examine if it is possible to eliminate one or more persons based on fact and fact alone. Are there any among us who could not have possibly been the culprit of any of the three murders so far?
Now we are talking. Let's look at that more closely. As regarding Mr. Masterson, could anyone have done it? Everyone had access to the liquor. As regarding the Rogers fellow, it had to be his wife, or Dr. Armstrong. They're the only one who would have administered the poison.
I protest!
This is absolutely uncalled for.
Dr. Armstrong,
I swear, what?
Your indignation is understandable, but Ms. Bloor is correct in saying that you and Ms. Rogers could have had the easiest time in carrying out the poisonings. But at the same time, all of us could have administered the drugs at some point.
This is outrageous. When we returned to this room, Miss Brent was standing over Rogers by the sofa. Is common humanity a criminal offense?
We are only establishing the facts. The brandy he was given could have also been laced by his wife, or the sedative he was given could have been tainted.
And that leads us where?
Well?
Well, true, it could have been, it could have been Miss... Could have been Mr. Sorry. It could have been Vera. It couldn't be Vera Clarethorne or Mr. Lombard or myself.
Not quite. After the brandy and the sedative, Rogers would have been in quite a stupor and would have accepted any pill or medicine given in the name of the doctor.
But we were all here for hours after he was brought to bed.
True, but somebody could have gone in there when Rogers went downstairs to clean up.
But then he would have been knocked out by the sedative.
Not necessarily. It's difficult to predict how much of an effect the drought would have had on him without prior treatment.
Well, that fits your story well.
There is no need for recriminations. Facts are what we have to deal with. Only through fact can we come to a real resolution. While it seems improbable that it was one of us, it is still possible.
And that gets us where? We have now dealt with the second killing and the fact that none of us is above suspicion, which brings us to the death of Colonel MacArthur.
Exactly. Can anyone bring an alibi which proves their innocence? I myself cannot. I was sitting on that chair on the terrace all morning, but there must have been times that I was unobserved, so I, in theory, could have snuck away.
I was with Mr. Lombard and Dr. Armstrong all morning. They'll bear me out.
No. You went to the house to look for a rope, and you were gone a long time.
What are you insinuating, Dr. Armstrong?
Nothing, just that you were awake quite a while.
It took time to find the rope. It's not like we have a coil of rope in the front closet.
And were the two of you together during that time?
Of course, though Lombard went off for a few minutes. I myself stayed where I was.
I was only trying to find the best spot to send a signal to the mainland. We're only apart a couple of minutes.
No kidding, Mr. Lombard. Only a couple minutes. Certainly wasn't long enough to commit a murder.
At what time did you separate?
I'm not sure. I didn't have a watch on.
I didn't think to look.
Well, a couple of minutes is a vague amount of time. And you, Miss Brent?
I took a walk with Miss Claythorne up to the top of the island. Afterwards, I sat on the terrace in the sun.
I didn't notice you there.
I was around the corner of the house to stay out of the wind.
And you were there?
Until lunchtime.
And Miss Claythorne?
I went for a walk with Miss Brent, as she said. And then I walked over to the general and had a short conversation with him.
What time was that?
I don't know, about an hour before lunch, I think. It could have been less. Was that before you'd spoken to him? I don't know. He was acting very strange.
In what way was he strange?
Well, he said we were all going to die. He said he was just waiting for the end. He frightened me.
And what did you do next?
I went inside the house, and then just before lunch, I went back outside the house. I've been terribly restless all day.
There still remains Miss Rogers, though I doubt that her evidence will add much to our knowledge.
I'll fetch her.
I'll go with you.
Miss Rogers, could you fill us in on your day up until now?
Yes, ma'am. After breakfast, I cleaned the dining room and set the table for lunch. Then I went to the kitchen to see if there was anything I could prepare without fresh food from the mainland. Then I brought a drink to you, and I didn't see the general outside.
And the soldier boys?
There were 8 this morning.
Okay, time for the summing up.
We have inquired into the stark circumstances of these 3 deaths to the best of our ability. And though it seems more probable that some are guilty than others, no one here is clear of all implication. I want to reiterate my belief that of all assembled here, one is an insane criminal. We are all in danger here, and since we have no evidence against any individual, we must set up measures which will increase our safety and find a way to make contact with the mainland. I will ask you all to think of what else you may take into account and what measures we can take to ensure our safety. We must stay on guard and stay suspicious of each other, avoid all risks, and keep close as a group. Court will now adjourn.
Thank you so much. Thank you. you for the drama troupe for that reenactment of a scene from And Then There Were None. And now we're moving on to Ms. Shelley Kaplowitz's rendition of The Mysteries of Flatbush.
The Yeshiva of Flatbush. This high school has stood on this spot for more than 50 years. And in that time, a lot of mysteries have unraveled in this building. Okay, so a bunch of teachers didn't come one weekend and try to kill each other off, but still interesting and perplexing things. Let's go inside and explore some of them.
You want to hear something really weird? This elevator goes nowhere. This is the service elevator. Except there don't seem to be doors on any other floor. There doesn't seem to be an elevator shaft, nothing. Just this. Is it fake? Is there a body buried behind this? Who knows?
Well, we've had some questions from kids also about, you know, some things that mystified them. So let's hear what they have to say.
And how many pairs of socks does Mr. Hofstadter own?
I don't know what you're talking about. I don't even wear socks.
Just how many sweaters does Mr. Engel actually own?
I knew this day would arrive, especially after that expose in the Phoenix last year. The number of sweaters that I have, well, it depends on the day, the weekend, the occasion, but by my estimate, I have somewhere roughly around 142 sweaters.
What goes on at those faculty meetings?
That's a good question. Really, they're kind of boring, to tell you the truth. You know, we talk about advancements in education and student philosophy. But if you're really interested, I could show you what it's like. Come with me. Okay, okay, hey. Well, that's weird. That never happens. All right, nothing to see. Let's go.
My question is, what is on the roof of this school?
Well, one of the biggest mysteries of Flatbush is, what's on the roof? Now, I know the urban myth. We've got tennis courts up there. But that's not true. There's nothing up there. It's just a roof. I mean, there's a satellite dish, there's some antennas, but there's nothing else up there. Look, come on, I'll show you. Take a look.
A lot of kids have asked what mysterious things go on in the teacher's room that we're never allowed in. Well, honestly, not so much. But why don't you take a look? I'll show you what.
She wore a nitsy bitsy.
Mr. Rothbart, aren't you supposed to be teaching class now?
I was marking regions. Marking regions.
Okay. Exactly where were you, Mr.
Rothbard? I can explain, but I wasn't on the roof. I wasn't in the pool. Can I just get in there? She wore an...
Yeah, no mystery. Nothing.
My question is, how did teachers get their job in Flatbush?
That's a really good question. Well, as some of you may know, teachers get their jobs here because they give model lessons in front of classes. Now, not everyone has had the opportunity to see that at work, but I unearthed an old piece of video from when someone was applying for a job as a history teacher. I haven't seen it yet either. I'm sure it's great. Let's take a look.
In 1930, the Republican-controlled House of Representatives, in an effort to alleviate the effects of the, anyone? The Great Depression, passed the, anyone? The tariff bill, the Hawley-Smoot Tariff Act, which anyone raised or lowered? Raised tariffs in an effort to collect more revenue for the federal government. Did it work? Anyone? Anyone know the effects? It did not work, and the United States sank deeper into the Great Depression. Today, we have a similar debate over this. Anyone know what this is, class? Anyone? Anyone? Anyone seen this before? The Laffer curve. Anyone know what this says? It says that at this point on the revenue curve, you will get exactly the same amount of revenue as at this point. This is very controversial. Does anyone know what Vice President Bush called this in 1980? Anyone? Something D-O-O economics. Voodoo economics.
And he ran from the school, never to be heard of again. So I guess there's some mysteries that never get solved. And that really is the thing, isn't it? That there's mystery even in ordinary life, here in Flatbush and anywhere. And that's what this woman knew. Agatha Christie saw the mystery in everyday average places, just like we do at school, at work, in our families, in our government. There's mysterious things afoot. And she could write fabulous stories about them, whether it took place on a train in Europe or in a remote English village or somewhere in the middle of the English Channel on an island that nobody can get to except by ferry. Agatha Christie found mystery in everything, and her work has lived on to this day. So, we dedicate this day to her, and we hope you enjoy discovering all of the mysteries that life has to offer. Have a great book day.